Okay, we're continuing on here with Thomas Reid's view of personal identity. Now, so far he said that it's just common sense that we are identical with ourselves through time, and in particular, it's our memory and the testimony of others also, which gives us evidence to show that we're the same person today as we were in the past, in past years. So far he's been focused on how do I know that I'm identical with myself through time. But what about this question? How do I know that you're the same person today as you were last week? And he says, well, basically you look the same. Here's what he says. Wherever we observe great similarity, we are apt to presume identity, even if no reason appears to the contrary. Two objects ever so like, when they are perceived at the same time, can't be the same. But if they are presented to our senses at different times, we are apt to think them the same, merely from their similarity. So, if I look at my daughter and she looks roughly the same as she looked last week, then I think she's the same person. It's the same one. If I see you in class 2 days in the week, then I can think, yeah, you look basically the same. I can see you got a haircut, but you're the same person. Now, this raises an interesting question because, Reid doesn't think that the person is their body. He thinks that the person is something which doesn't have parts. In other words, he thinks the person is an invisible soul. So, why should we think that just because you physically look the same, that you are the same actually? That is, the person that you are has remained the same. If persons are not their bodies, then we don't observe them directly, and we don't observe the similarity of the person from time to time directly. At most, we observe the similarity of the organism with which they're associated. But so far, we don't have any argument for the claim that there is a person in each human organism. After all, some of you might be zombies. And we don't have an argument to show that similar organisms contain similar persons. Now, what's Reid going to say to all this? How's he going to show that, if you got similar bodies, there's a similar person inside or the same person inside? I don't know. I'm guessing that Reid's going to say, well, you don't need an argument. All that stuff is common sense. After all, Reid always punts to common sense. We can trust common sense, and we ought to. So it's just common sense that if you got a person who looks the same as last week physically, then the actual person inside them is the same person. Is that satisfying? Maybe, maybe not. What's your story? You got a better answer? Tell me. Now, our last point from Thomas Reid that we want to cover is his argument for dualism. And this is actually probably pretty obvious. Actually, it brings us really back to the very beginning and the argument for dualism from personal identity. Reid's really making a version of that. Here's what Reid's claiming. Bodies have certain characteristics which persons can't have. Bodies have parts. Persons, as he's argued, have no parts. Bodies lack perfect identity. At most, they have imperfect identity. Persons, he says, clearly do have perfect identity. And then finally, he says, bodies are inert. Now, what does he mean by that? He means physical objects don't move themselves. They have to be moved by something external. They're not self-activating. Persons, he says, are active. They're not inert. Persons make choices and have thoughts and act without being pushed or pulled by anything else. They have a self-activating power to them. Now, for all those reasons, he says persons cannot be identical with their bodies. And what that means is he's a dualist. He thinks that you've got the person themselves is really a soul. That the mind, the consciousness, the person is not identical with any physical object. So he's a dualist. Yeah, that's Reid's story. Take it, leave it, think about it the rest of your life.